Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming to what I hope will be an enjoyable evening for you. I wanted to point out a couple of things. We have some information at the front desk if any of you are considering going to graduate school in education. And then part of this, a half hour or more if you need it, is going to be devoted to answering your questions. If you feel comfortable standing up and asking the questions, then I'll pass the mic to you. But if you'd like to write down your questions, I will come around later on and pick those up for you if you'd rather do it that way, because we really do want you to take this opportunity to learn from people who can tell you what are the kinds of careers there are for people who are teacher education majors. And before I introduce the panel members, I would like to introduce Dr. Jeff Wonko, who's the Associate Dean and Professor of the College of Education, Health and Society, and he is going to introduce the program.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Appreciate it. Good evening, everybody. Nice to see you. Thanks for being here tonight. My name is Jeff Wonko. I'm Associate Dean for Undergraduate Affairs in the College of Education, Health and Society. I'm also a professor in the Department of Teacher Education in Mathematics Education. So, yay math. All right. So what I wanted to do tonight is just to welcome you here and just to talk to you real briefly about this. And I thought a way to introduce this is to just tell you just very briefly about myself and use that as a segue here. I'm a former middle school math teacher. I taught middle school mathematics in the King's Local School District. And then I started my doctoral work and found my way back here to Miami. I say back here because this is where I got my undergraduate degree here at Miami as well. So for me, my route in education was through the classroom and then eventually back to some classroom support. But as I have contacted and been in contact with a number of people who I was in the education program with here at Miami and others who I know as well, I see a number of my colleagues doing other things outside of the classroom. And one thing that reminds me of is that the skill set that teachers develop as classroom educators is a fantastic set of skills that enables them to do a number of other things throughout their careers. And many of them start off as teachers and then find their ways into other things with curriculum support, with technology applications, and a number of other fields as well, which you'll get to hear about some examples here tonight. So one of the things I just wanted to just remind you of is the skills that you develop as a teacher, working with individuals, working with kids, and just being a professional are a fantastic set of skills that will help you with whatever you pursue down the road. And so that's what we wanted to do tonight, is to introduce you to some of these ideas and to help you also to see that some of these things that you are doing right now that you're developing as a future teacher and as a classroom teacher, they will enable you to be a much, much better educator as well as whatever field it is that you might pursue. So I thank you, I welcome you tonight, and enjoy the program.
All right, let me introduce the panel. And just to let you know, you've got your mics there. And if you'd rather hold this, I'll give this back to you, or you can have the lapel one. So you want to put those on. All right, so let me start to my left, your right. Natasha Allen, and I'm not going to say too much because that's a part of what this panel is going to be, is each panel is talking, telling you what their story and their background is. But Natasha Allen is an instructional design consultant at Tier 1 Performance Solutions. And she has a strong connection to Miami that I will let her tell you about. And next to her is Jennifer Gardner, who's Vice President Human Resources for the Highlights family of companies. And she'll tell you a little bit about that. And there also, back there, was a sheet of examples of jobs at the Highlight Company that I hope you picked up, because I think it'll give you a good example of probably the types of jobs you never thought about before this evening. And then next is Megan Cascown, who is the volunteer manager at the Aronoff Center for the Arts in Cincinnati, also a graduate of Miami's education program. And then Genesis Ross, who is currently working on her PhD in Miami's educational leadership program. But as you saw in the newsletter, she also has a degree in early childhood education. So on that note, we're going to start out, and I think that, would you mind starting, Natasha, to give maybe a 10-minute introduction and talk a little bit about what your background is, and then we'll just keep going. And then after that, we'll ask questions. There'll be time for you to ask questions, so keep track of what you want, write them down, and then I'll be around. So, okay.
Thank you.
So, as you heard, my name is Natasha Allen. I am an instructional design consultant with Tier 1 Performance Solution. We are a small agency. Our mission is to improve the performance of organizations by improving the performance of their people. So I'll talk a little bit about what that means. But first, what on earth is instructional design? Surprisingly few people know. I was a graduate student in the English department up until last year. And when I spoke to my graduate advisor about instructional design, not only did she not know what the career was, she was not aware that we had an instructional design master's program here at Miami, which we do. So when I tell people what I do, I typically get a blank stare. They don't know what I do. Or when I try to explain that it has to do with workplace training and workplace education, they assume I'm the person behind those boring, cheesy, 30-minute videos that they had to watch, or those e-learning modules that they were forced to take. But I promise you it's not boring, and I'll talk about that as well. So I'm going to begin with my background, explain what instructional designers do. I'll also, of course, talk about how my teaching experience prepared me for the career, what you might expect if you are thinking of entering the field of instructional design, and what are some of the common requirements that employers look for in potential instructional design candidates. So a little bit about me. I began my educational career with the goal of teaching English and post-secondary professor of English. I completed my bachelor's degree in English at UC, my master's here at Miami, and I made it most of the way through my PhD program, finished all of the coursework. But it did come to a point where I had to be honest about the need to look at alternative careers because right now things are tight. There are a lot of English PhD candidates. There are a few positions that they're contending for. I do have a family. I have 3 children, and I had to be honest about the fact that I needed to look outside. So I was looking for a career that would let me make use of the skills that I had developed teaching English. First and second year composition here at Miami for 5 years. Don't know if any of my former students are in the room. So I transitioned out of my initially chosen career field in 2013, and I joined Tier 1 Performance Solutions after realizing that my skills were a good match for what it is that they were looking for. So let's talk about what it is that instructional designers do. So as an instructional designer, I plan and develop technical training. So Ruth Clark, which is one of the leading theorist in the field, describes technical training as a structured learning environment engineered to improve workplace performance in ways that are aligned with bottom line business goals. It's a very dry definition. Hopefully I can expand upon it. So the learning that I develop might be virtual. So it might be an e-learning module, might be a video, might be an electronic performance support tool, maybe something that while someone's on the job, they can pull out their iPad, they can pull out their mobile phone, they can get the information they need, just-in-time information to perform their jobs. Or the learning environment might be an instructor-led training event. So there might be some type of training. For example, Procter & Gamble recently had a senior researcher college event. They invited in senior researchers from across the country, and our company was tasked with helping them design this event. So in that case, we will prepare the facilitator and the participants by developing facilitator guides, participant guides, and helping them structure the training. So there are 4 primary areas in which instructional design is practiced. First, in education, so in a university or a school setting. Next, corporate, so that can be profit, that can be nonprofit. You would be part of a learning department or group within an organization, and you'll work for internal clients within the organization. There is government instructional design, which involves instructional design for a variety of government agencies and organizations. And honestly, instructional design really came out of government processes, so that's really a home for instructional design. And finally, there's what I do, which is consulting. So in those cases, you're contracted by organizations to step in to help improve the performance of their people, find learning solutions that are going to help them align with what they need to do. So it's really something that I feel passionately about, honestly, because I'm helping people do their best work. I'm helping people be able to fulfill their potential. And as a consultant, I'm able to work in all of the other three areas I mentioned. So I've done some educational instructional design, working with Gateway Community College in Kentucky to develop an instructional design program. I've done corporate instructional design. The only one I haven't done, well, a little bit, is government instructional design, simply because I haven't been put on those projects, but it is an option open to me. So good instructional design is never boring. It's not those boring videos that you're being forced to sit through when you first start the job. If it's boring, it's not good instructional design. The point of instructional design is to really draw in the participants or the learners to act on their needs, act on their motivations, get them enthusiastic, and get them willing to take ownership of their learning. So instructional design typically follows proven processes. There's a large body of theory, a large body of work around what makes up good instructional design. And that's not to say that it's always done the same way. You very much need to bring your creativity to the field. But there are certain processes that have been known as the industry standard, such as the ADDIE model of instructional design. And ADDIE is an acronym for Analyze, Design, Develop, Implement, and Evaluate. So just briefly to tell you what that means. We start off by analyzing the need. So we sit down with the client, and I'm speaking from a consulting perspective, although if you work in another type of organization, you still have your internal clients. But you sit down with the client and you discover the need. You ask strategic questions. You really become a researcher, trying to discover what it is exactly that the participants, the learners, need to do or need to find out or need to believe or understand in order for them to do their jobs well. And you develop instructional goals called learning objectives that speak to those needs. Next, you design a plan for meeting that need. So that would mean outlining the course if you're developing a course, outlining the performance support tool if that's what you're developing. Then you develop the learning materials, and that usually involves storyboarding. So it's actually writing out every piece of the event. So if I'm creating an e-learning module, and let's say there's two characters who are talking to each other, I'm writing out the script, I'm writing out the narrative voiceover. I'm writing out the multiple choice questions or the reflection activity. Each piece of the learning event needs to be designed. Finally, there's implementing the learning event. Now, this I have less involvement in. This is where our tech team really comes into play. If it's an e-learning course, that might mean getting with the client, finding out about their LMS, their learning system, what delivery platforms we're using, and making sure that it's working well. And finally, there's evaluating the learning event. So evaluating is making sure that we understand not only how the learners responded to the learning event, but also what were the results? How did they change their behaviors or their performance as a result of going through the learning event? What was the business results as a result of the learning event? Did the company get their money's worth? And good instructional designers are very invested in learning what works and what doesn't, and constantly testing and refining their methods and their techniques. So my background as an instructor here in Miami has prepared me for this career in three key ways. So the years I've spent developing curriculum for the classroom taught me how to break desired performance into small steps. So I'm sure all of you understand that. What is it that you want your students to be able to do? How can we get them there? What is the end result? Where are we trying to get them? What is the gap in knowledge or skills that's keeping them from being able to do what it is they need to do to be successful? Learning to search for resources to use in the classroom taught me to identify the best available resources for conveying information and how to synthesize what I found into a coherent lesson or framework to present to my classroom. So that's been invaluable for me in helping me design modules in which the client maybe doesn't have all of the information or all of the content that I need for the course, or where they just give me an overload of PowerPoints that have been developed over the years and various materials, and I have to dig through them and try to find the information that I need to make a really engaging, interesting learning experience. Finally, my time in the classroom taught me to think from the student's perspective. And those of you in the room who have a teaching experience know the experience of getting really excited about a lesson plan or an activity you developed, and you just can't wait to get in front of the class and do it, and then you're just getting blank stares in response. And it teaches you to think from the student's perspective. Why was this not connecting with them? How can I rephrase this or reword it or restructure it in such a way that they really feel engaged? And that's a very important part of instructional design: audience analysis, understanding your learner. So here's what to expect if you're thinking of going into a career of instructional design. First of all, let me talk to you about what I found to be rewarding as opposed to what I previously did teaching here in Miami, what I found to be a welcome change. First, there are various projects and challenges. So I really love English literature, I do. But when I found myself teaching the same material over and over again, particularly when I had multiple classes in the day and I began repeating myself, it became very repetitive. Well, with instructional design, always a new project, always a new objective. So it's very dynamic, very much new things that you, entirely different contexts and learners and objectives for you to take on with each project. There is less facilitation. So if you're the type of person who really loves being in front of the classroom, this career choice may not be for you. I did find that for me, the part of teaching that I liked the most was course planning, was designing those activities, was finding the right text and the right information to convey. So for me, less facilitation actually was a plus, but that again is something where you'll have to ask yourself what it is that you really want to do. And finally, no grading. Need I say more? as a literature instructor, there were a lot of 6-page essays, stacks of them, and you know, it's really great to engage with my students and hear their ideas, but it became very time consuming, and I didn't mind stepping away from the grading. I'll just leave that there. Some differences between what you're doing now and what you might do in instructional design. Right now you focus on pedagogy, which is a word that comes from Greek roots that if you translate it means to lead the child. Well, with instructional design, we're looking more at andragogy. You want to Wikipedia that, that's andragogy. And essentially that is a theory of adult learning, and adult learners are very different than learners in K through 12. Adult learners have different expectations and motivations. Adult learners need to know why they're learning. They don't like to just do things because they're told to do them. Adult learners need to be able to base what they're learning on their wide range of experiences. Adult learners are bringing a lot to the classroom and they need to be able to connect in that way. They need to be involved in the planning and the evaluation of their learning. They need to feel as if they're active participants. What they're learning needs to have immediate relevance to their personal and professional lives. We're talking about people who have families. We're talking about people who have work responsibilities they've stepped away from in order to engage in this learning event, and you need to show them exactly why it's worth it. Adult learning needs to focus on solving a problem rather than just covering content. And finally, adult learners respond better to external versus internal motivation. So gold stars aren't as effective for adult learners as that feeling of personal accomplishment. So they're a very different audience. So good instructional designers keep these points in mind when designing learning events. So what is it that employers are looking for? Understanding learning is fundamentally the most important aspect of being a good designer of learning programs, and you all obviously have come quite a long way in understanding learning, how it happens, and how different aspects of the memory function in order to get the knowledge to the learner and help them retrieve it when they need it. So your education major has prepared you well in that respect. Typically, instructional designers are expected to hold a master's degree in one of several fields, perhaps education psychology, education technology, instructional design. English works pretty well as well. It's important to have strong writing and research skills, very important, as well as the ability to think strategically because you are very much a problem solver as an instructional designer. It's also very important to be able to bring your creativity to each project and be willing to take at times unique approaches in order to accomplish the given objective. And some employers may expect you to be competent in using certain programs or designing in certain programs such as Adobe Flash, Articula Storyline, Lectora. Personally, I appreciate that my employer expects me to be an expert in learning theory and learning design. And then we have other consultants in my firm who are brilliant at taking these other programs and making something spectacular. And it really just allows us to become experts in our own area. But depending on the employer, you may be expected to be a jack of all trades, to design the event, to develop the learning module within a given program and to implement it. And finally, it helps be motivated by a strong need to take on a challenge, to accomplish an objective and to find creative ways to do so. Instructional designers are always at the drawing board, so to speak. So your motivation really needs to rest in the satisfaction of sound, effective design. So that's it. And
thank you.
I'll be happy to take more questions when we get to the end of the panel.
Let me bring up. Welcome on up, Nicole. I'd like to introduce Nicole Lewin, who works with Natasha at Tier 1. She's a recruiter, and she is late because of what? Traffic on 27, of course. So, okay, welcome.
Sorry.
No, that's right. Okay, go ahead, Jennifer.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jennifer Gardner. I am the Vice President of Human Resources for the Highlights family of companies. I am actually also a Miami graduate, and I started out in the education program. I was an education major for a year and a half and felt a draw a little bit more to the business side of things. I ended up getting a double major in communications and public relations and started work with an insurance company as a claims adjuster. It was the only job I could get. It was quite by accident that I ended up falling into training and development. And so a couple of years into my work there, they were redesigning their whole training organization. And I was young enough and dumb enough to think, well, gosh, I could do that. And so I applied, and they actually hired me to do that. And that was when I first found out about human resources. Really fell in love with it. I ended up going back to school at nights and got my master's in labor and human resources. And really did, it brought together for me my passion that I had really loved and what had drawn me to education in the first place, but also my love for business. And so really kind of backwards ended up getting some of that foundation and pedagogy relative to adult learning and what it meant in a business environment, and everything from technical training to business acumen and business skills, the whole needs assessment, everything that Natasha was talking about, it just brought all of that back for me. And I'm still in human resources, and I have somebody who leads organizational development and talent and development for me in my current job, and every job that I've had since that very first one has had some element of adult learning in a business environment as part of it. I have hired my very first educator as a training and development manager when I led that department. There was a woman who had been an educator. She had been a classroom instructor for early elementary school education. She had taken some time off because she started to kind of feel herself getting a little bit burnt out from the classroom environment and kind of wanted to reinvent herself. And she found her way into kind of bridging the best of both worlds in the position that she took with me as a training specialist. And does that to this day, has gone on and moved on to different organizations and done different things. But again, that was a really nice bridge for her. And I think for all of you, as I thought about coming here today, one of the things as I thought back, I want to talk specifically about the company that I'm with now, but it is interesting, people with education degrees, with the experience and skill set that you have, you probably don't realize until you start exploring all of the different avenues that you can go in, and thinking about that many years ago, hiring the first person with an education major and what I've seen her do with her career. And as an HR person, I coach people constantly on their careers from what they want to do now at your stage, kind of going through what kind of career path you want to take from an education standpoint. But I always joke that throughout our entire lives, we go through a what do I want to be when I grow up phase. Where we kind of rethink ourselves and reinvent ourselves. And one of the things that I hope you can take away from the conversations with all of us today is you can start out in education and you can reinvent yourself. It's not an either-or proposition. You have a lot of options available to you that may change paths as you go along your careers. And so some of the things that I'll talk about at the company that I'm with now, I will talk about in the context of things that you could do right out of undergrad with a degree in education versus things that if you had some years of experience under your belt would probably be a better fit. A little bit about me. I started in education, ended up with coming out of the communication side of the house, worked my way into human resources, got my master's degree, and I've held a number of jobs throughout my career. Started off with an insurance company, again in a variety of jobs throughout the HR organization. Moved to a professional services firm, Deloitte, in HR, but again, one of the jobs that I held while I was there, I led talent and development for our organization for the US practice. So again, have always been engaged with the adult education kind of arm of things. And then I made the move about 4 years ago to the Highlights family of companies. Just quick show of hands, how many of you remember Highlights from when you were in the doctor's or dentist's office or got a subscription at home? We are still alive and well, and actually probably a whole lot more than what you may remember from when you all were kids. So Goofus and Gallant are still around, I'm happy to say, and Hidden Pictures are still everybody's favorite. But we also have, that is our flagship magazine. We have three magazines now, and we're really focusing on children from 0 to 12. So we have Hello, which is the largest publication magazine in the country for babies. Yes, there is a magazine for babies. And it is about introducing language to children 0 to 2. We have High Five, which is a magazine for kids in the 2 to 5 year range, and then Highlights, which you recall, which is, you know, kind of the 6 to 9, and we are building out our 9 to 12 age pillar. In addition to those three kind of core magazines, we have a number of continuities, which are kind of book clubs, that kind of thing, puzzle clubs, Which Way USA, about each of the 50 states, Math Mania, Puzzle Mania. We have a number of products. We are in 43 countries, so we're global, all around the world, and we have all kinds of digital apps. Yes, you can download an app to do a hidden picture on your iPhones. I have it, and it's fun. I don't care how old you are, it's still fun. From an education standpoint, one of the things that Highlights has is a teacher page. So we have teacher editions of Highlights and High Five. That teachers can use in their classroom with tips and ideas on how to do that, lesson plans, that kind of thing. So again, if you do go into the teaching profession, that's a great resource for you, and something that you know will be good quality education material that you can use in a productive and healthy way for your kids. One of the things that the whole Highlights family of companies is built around is our mission statement, that we are here to serve children, their parents, grandparents, and educators who serve them to help children become their best selves, curious, caring, and confident. And so everything that we do is about that. So the Highlights that you remember has grown considerably, as you can tell, into a global family media brand, and continuing to grow today as we speak. But we also have three wholly owned companies that are on our education arm. We refer to them as our education group. And so some of those companies, although they are wholly owned subsidiaries of Highlights, they stand on their own in terms of their own brand, so you may know them as well. One is Staff Development for Educators, and it is a company that is completely about the professional development for teachers and administrators, doing live public events. One of our largest events is a live public event in Las Vegas every summer. We have about 6,000 to 8,000 teachers from around the country and some internationally that come to attend a 5-day workshop on a variety of topics. So everything, there's a whole unit that specializes on teaching kindergarten. There are others that are focused and targeted to administrators and math subject areas, that kind of thing. And it is one of the most powerful events that I personally have ever been to see that passion of educators harnessed in one place and hear what they're talking about and what they want to bring back to their classrooms. We also do customized training for either school districts or actual schools on a variety of topics as well. And again, if you are looking for resources yourself, if you go directly into education, the websites are all on here, but there is an area on staff development for educators that is dedicated to teachers to give you tips and ideas and lesson plans. There's a blog by our president all about creating an exceptional classroom. And then we have Stenhouse Publishing, which is book, video, professional development. We refer to it as by teachers, for teachers, really based in sound theory and philosophy. They also have a website that you can get onto to access different materials. And given how many of you are as far along as you are in your education program, many of you may have even done some research on the book, The Daily Five. Is anybody familiar with that? The sisters, very renowned in the education group, the authors, we just came out with our second edition, but that's one of our books that we publish, and we work with them on a lot of the things that they do. So there's some great things that are out there for educators. And then our third wholly owned subsidiary company in the education group is Zahner Bloser. A lot of people may recall working with Zahner Bloser again when they were kids because we started as a handwriting company. Did any of you remember working on the line paper and the whole, yeah? That was Zahner Bloser. That is Zahner Bloser. And as a matter of fact, you know, still alive and well today, we refer to ourselves as a curriculum company because our curriculum comes as you need it in multiple media. And avenues both for you in terms of materials, books, whiteboard apps, that kind of thing. So again, multi-layered. And we have expanded. Handwriting is still one of our core cornerstones for the business, but we have great breadth in our focus on pre-K now through eighth grade. One of the things that Zahner Bloser has been really great about is going beyond the world of curriculum development and really focusing on helping educators with the priorities with everything that's going on from a governmental standpoint, from an industry standpoint, from just the way we are as a world. There has been really deep research done on the importance of handwriting and the development that, you know, as we go to so much digital and electronic, kids are actually missing a piece of brain development when they aren't learning handwriting, and especially cursive handwriting. And so we're working with a lot of the states and the state legislatures as they are thinking about their core and making sure that handwriting is a part of it. You know, certainly we're a for-profit business, so there's a financial incentive. But again, you go back to our mission statement, the more important thing is what happens to kids. And we don't know that yet. What happens to kids? We know that there's an impact on their brain, but we don't know exactly what happens to them down the road if they lose that piece of development because they've lost handwriting. And it's not the act of handwriting, it's what happens with the engagement with the brain. So we're doing a lot of early research and a lot of lobbying and that kind of thing, helping support the different state districts. And again, a website that has rich information for educators. So that really leads me a little bit to what are some of the jobs for you? And some of it might seem pretty logical and practical in terms of we have professional development. Natasha and I have both talked a lot about the whole idea of adult education, and certainly that's been a powerful space for us. Most of the people that actually present the learnings, the materials, are prior educators. And so there's a really rich career, and as a matter of fact, it can also be a supplemental career for people who are currently teaching, because a lot of the live events occur during the summer months, or they occur during natural breaks for teachers, because that's when you're not in the classroom. So we have a lot of current and former teachers that have really taken that up. They are authors, they are presenters, they are real leaders and innovators in the education space. And so for people who have a lot of creativity, a lot of ideas, and that desire to help other educators bring their best selves to the classroom, it's a great space for you to consider working in. Also, with all of those live events, we have sales arms, we have the people who are actually working the events, helping the people who are attending kind of figure out, you know, 5 days, hundreds and hundreds of options that they can go to, helping them piece together the right events for them to go to help. So there are a number of jobs within that organization. With Stenhouse Publishing, we also have a number of people who are former teachers, who are editors, who are actually working with our writers to help them through that. We do also have a couple of people in our sales and marketing area in that company that also have education backgrounds. And then certainly with Zinger Blozer, literally every pocket of our business, from customer service to our editorial staff to our sales staff, are founded in, not exclusively, but the majority of them are prior educators. And again, we have some current educators in those spaces that help supplement some of our sales arm as a supplement to their full-time job, which is teaching. So they work for us part-time, just on an as-available and as-needed basis. And then our Highlights company, most people don't necessarily think of Highlights being a company that would hire educators, but yet our focus is on literacy for children. So again, we have a number of people who are in our editorial staff, some that are in our sales staff, and we even have some people that have made the leap and really embedded themselves in the business side of the house, working in marketing and creative, and some of those areas, some of our social media areas, really focusing on those opportunities. So we are excited about what we do. We are, I'm going to use a word that you used, and I think it's a theme that you'll hear from all of us. We are passionate about educators and what you do, but we are also passionate about the value that educators bring to us in helping to serve children.
Hello. My name is Megan Cascown, and I am the volunteer manager at the Aronoff Center for the Arts, and that will be the last place on earth I ever thought I would be when I graduated in 1990. My education degree was in physical education K-12, which actually served me really well for my career trajectory. When I graduated in 1990, that was, I will say, the beginning of the end for physical education as an actual field of focus for education. That's my own personal bias, so don't throw things at me. It just seemed to have lost a focus as far as importance in education. I grew up in a family of educators. Every one of my aunts and uncles were an educator. Both my parents were educators, and they all went to school in the 50s and learned that era of educating, and I looked up to every one of them. And I was the only one in our family who went into education and never took it beyond that. A, because I couldn't find a job in 1990, and B, because it wasn't the education I saw them doing. So again, my own personal experience with it. When I graduated, I took the only job I could get in the summer, which was an activities coordinator, recreation coordinator at a day camp, actually a residential camp, Camp Allen, outside of Cincinnati. It was a residential camp, week long at a time, for people with severe disabilities, wide range of disabilities. And I had never worked with anybody with disabilities before in my life. So it was trial by fire. And I will say that my education degree in phys ed led me up to that really nicely. Besides the fact that I wasn't in a classroom, a structured box space, I was in a chaotic gym trying to hoard little kids and big kids into what I wanted them to do. Putting adults and children all in one activity out in the middle of a soccer field, trying to get everybody doing one thing or the other, and they all had different abilities, tested my limits of thinking on my feet. And in any classroom situation you will ever find yourselves in, it is thinking on your feet that will get you through. Now, yes, you have your plan of action, but nothing ever really goes as your plan of action unless you have a very good day. So that was my first job. I continued to interview for teaching jobs throughout the summer. I got hired on by the parent company, Stepping Stone Center, as the early intervention coordinator, again, with people and children with disabilities, some of which I had never heard of. So I took my learning and continued it on my own time and did the best that I could. Now, will I tell you I was really good at it? No, not at all. I will say I came at it from a totally different perspective than perhaps any other educator going into that field might have. And again, it came from my background in phys ed, where it was mostly motor learning and trying to get people active. And I always tied that to what you could learn from that in other realms of education. So if you learned how to roll over in a ball, then you were learning other aspects of life skills. And so I took that and focused more on working with people, working with their life skills, and that is where my emphasis turned out to be, not so much on curriculum design and pedagogy. It was taking those abilities to learn on the fly, to restructure what I thought was structured and come up with something new in about a 3-minute time span when I looked out and saw wasn't going as I was planning. My next job was working at a residential home for people with severe and multiple profound disabilities as the activities coordinator. And about a month into that, they offered me another $1,000, seemed like a lot of money at the time, to take on the volunteer aspect of that, which is basically, volunteer management is basically HR for the unpaid staff. And so I found my focus and my area of interest because it was learning a new skill, going towards the way of working with volunteers. And again, it was teaching them as I was learning. It was teaching them about how to work with people with disabilities, how to engage students from local schools in creating projects for those residents, might have been a haunted house, and encouraging them to be as creative as possible to create that experience for the residents. So I always saw what I was doing as teaching, whether it was the volunteers coming in or the residents of the home. From there, after 7 years there, I was hired on as the volunteer manager at the Aronoff Center, and I've been there for 15 years. It has been a unique process to get where I am as far as comfort level in my own skill set. And again, it was learning as I went. Again, it was teaching volunteers where we needed them to be and ascertaining what their skills were. How many of you have been in the out in the field already doing some student learning, student training? How many times have you had to sit and look at the classroom and figure out where they were? And this person wasn't on the same page as this person, and that one in the back was sleeping. You know, so you're having to figure out where people are coming from and adjust how you are teaching them as you go, what skills you are trying to offer them and get them to learn in the situations they are. Right now, my focus seems to be more on customer service skills and making sure people are playing nice with each other. Out of the 800 volunteers, I often get people comparing it to my job as herding cats. And it's similar. And again, I go back to, and by no means do I mean this to be an insulting comment, working with 800 people who range in age from 18 to 93 puts my level of skill and all the learning I had for teaching elementary kids through high school kids into practice almost every day. Because it's amazing to me how in groups and the more folks seem to age, and this is a broad sweeping generalization, so take it that way, people often revert back to how they acted in kindergarten. And so you have to learn those skill sets and be able to manage those environments. So the teaching of a skill set, learning how to manage that space, trusting in your own ability to figure out where people are, whether that's creating a presentation for a general orientation, which I do now, giving an overview of the organization, and then coming in and doing the hands-on specific training to be an usher, to be a tour guide, to work in our offices with our education department. At the Aronoff Center for the Arts, actually for the Cincinnati Arts Association, which is the company I work for, we manage the Aronoff Center, which is a state-owned building, and Music Hall, which is a city-owned building. And I am specifically in the Aronoff Center. However, our corporate offices, corporate if you will. Everything I've worked on has been not-for-profit, including CAA. The corporate offices are housed within the Aronoff Center, and so I do a lot of work with the other departments. And one of our strongest departments is our education department. And I love talking about it because they do education by reaching backwards into the schools. And our staff who are in the education department, some are former educators, some kind of found their way into there from an arts background, and it's working out very nicely. So there are three prongs in our organization in that program. The first is working with local and regional artists and sending them out into the schools, coordinating with the schools and setting up those programs and allowing the artists to learn how to be educators, because we do follow up with them and we evaluate their teaching skills and we evaluate the program they're doing. And I've found myself tapping into our volunteer pool of previous educators who I can say, you have excellent skills. Would you mind going out and volunteering to see how they're doing and give feedback on how they're doing? So that's our Artists on Tour program. We also have a school time program where we coordinate with the schools and we bring classrooms into the theater and let them see their first live performances. And there is nothing better than watching students walk in, five and younger, and then up to high school age, and they walk in and they all just stop and look around and say, wow, your house is big. Or, this is TV, isn't it? No, we can't hit rewind, I'm sorry. So it's the entire engagement process of those students when they come into our facility and encouraging our volunteers when they're leading them into the theater and when they're leading them out to continue that interaction, engage them, ask them what they learned, ask them how they enjoyed it, how it was different from their classroom, how it was different from TV, and what did they like about it. And that is all education to me. That is all engaging their brain and letting them think up something new as they're going forward. But that's education outside of a classroom. Very practical, very hands-on. Our tour guides, a lot are former teachers. They like to be in charge. They like to lead groups along and say, here's what you need to know. And it's all I can do to say, you don't have to give them every bit of information in your brain. Let them learn and let them lead you into what is interesting to them. There is no curriculum here. We are sharing information about the facility, the organization, what theater is, how they might want to get involved, what opportunities there are in theater. Those are also fun. So it's reteaching teachers how to teach differently, which is a fascinating process. Again, for me, my education degree goes back to managing the chaos, putting out a focus, a goal of what I want to do, and using those organizational skills to get us there. For example, when I started, our orientation program for bringing ushers on was a three-hour meeting. It still is, it's just structured differently. A three-hour meeting where we crammed every bit of information about the usher program into one, let them go, and said, now go be ushers. I don't know about you, but if I sat down for a three-hour meeting and was given a manual and was lectured to and shown a few overheads, I would have been overwhelmed. So we stopped and I worked with some of my staff and we looked at it and said, they're adults, we're overwhelming them. They've got the glazed look once they get done, and then we start bringing them in a month later to work the shows and they've forgotten everything we wanted them to know. There's no way to make sure that they are comfortable with that information. So we re-looked at that training program and said, okay, if I was in this program, how would I want to learn? And we started asking each other and other people and our former our volunteers who went through the training. And they said, you know, when I started, it would have been great to know what the expectations were before I even went to the orientation, so I knew if I wanted to go. So we're starting with a base of knowledge there, giving them the option to choose in or not. Again, totally different structure of education. We then started interviewing them. We had current volunteers interview them, ask where they were coming from, what they wanted to learn, basically, what did they want to get out of the experience, and say, here are the protocols, here are the expectations. Are you okay with that? Then they were invited to the orientation, and before they got to the orientation, I gave them a written quiz. And it's a take-home quiz. I give them the page numbers. Basically, I want them to walk through the manual, write down the answers, and have an overview of it, get a good general understanding before we sit down and talk about things in a much broader scope, and then get down to the nitty-gritty halfway through. Walk them through the building, say, here's what a typical night will look like, who has questions, what are the next steps. That has helped them on their first nights be a little more comfortable with where they're coming from. They're still terrified because we're talking about coming in and helping 2,700 people to their seats, and they're not really sure they know where those seats are. So the first two nights, we put them with somebody else. We give them a mentor program, and we call them volunteers in training and tell them to use their name tags wisely, and if they mess up, I'm still training. It's a good tool for them. So it's giving them permission to make those mistakes. It's giving that human being the tools and skill sets they need learning over time, but it's also giving them permission to fail and learn as they go. So again, it's, for my perspective, it's putting practical applications in place from teaching phys ed, from coaching. It's constantly giving feedback. It's constantly saying, hey, you know what? The way you interacted with that patron last night, I got all kinds of rave reviews. Thank you very much for doing what you did. Keep it up. Or, the way you said that to that patron they called and they weren't real happy with it, please make sure you do it a little differently. Remember, perspective is everything. Perception is everything. So it's, again, constantly giving feedback, constantly trying to get people to where you need them to be. So, how I used my education degree progressively built upon itself to where I am now. I am in the phase right now of saying, what do I want to be when I grow up? And I'm kind of looking in the HR direction, and I'm kind of not. I find it really fun to stand up in front of some of my colleagues and teach programs, lead training sessions, hour and a half training sessions for my colleagues and at state conventions. That brings me a lot of joy to be able to stand up and ask questions. And anytime I approach a group, I never say I'm the expert. I say this is a room full of experts. Let's have a conversation. And your teaching style is very much based on your personality style. And you have to work with that. And if it's not in a classroom setting, then you very much have to think about where it is. If it's in a corporate setting, which mine was not, excellent, go for it. Mine is in a much more laid back frame of mind setting. I like working in not-for-profit world. That's a good fit for me. I will say that I was chuckling when Natasha said adult learners don't like gold stars. I beg to differ. We have a volunteer program that honors years of service. And so when you hit the five-year mark, our volunteers get a little gold star that says the number 5 on it. And then there's a 10-year star, and then we're going up to our 20-year star because we're starting our 20-year anniversary next season. And, you know, I thought it was just a nice little gesture. I can't tell you how many times I get asked throughout the year, when am I getting my pin? When am I getting my pin? Like, wait another 3 months. You'll be fine. So little things like that, they may seem silly, it may seem like they're not necessarily going to respond to that, but sometimes they do. Sometimes they respond to things that, those little incentives, those little pieces of feedback you give them, more than you would ever expect. So never stop looking for those pieces of it. Never stop thinking that one way is the only way because you're dealing with people. How many of you got into this field because you loved a subject and that was the only reason you went into education? Excellent, didn't think so. How many of you went into it because you love people? That's who you'll be working with no matter what field of expertise you follow with your education degree. So use it. Use the skill sets you're using from your education degree, that program, that organizational skills, that way of interacting with people and seeing where they are, finding out what their interests are, finding out what level they are so you can catch them up to everybody else. Those all translate into, I would say, any job you take. And that's probably not very helpful for you because you want to know where you can go. If you don't go into teaching, I would say you could go anywhere. Education is sales. You're selling that subject. You're selling their self-esteem. You are selling whatever product it is you have in front of you. And that may sound like a cold comparison if you're not into sales, but truth be told, that's what it is.
Well, hello. Can you all hear me? Okay.
Just a little closer.
A little bit closer. All right. Well, I just want to kind of talk to you all about why education became not, I'm sorry, why I did not decide to go into teaching. Then kind of talk to you all about some of the things that I was able to do as a result of having the skill sets that came with my education degree. And then I would like to offer some strategies to kind of help you all figure out maybe how you can apply your degree to figure out what it is that you want to do if you find yourself maybe in limbo. So first off, my undergrad degree was in early childhood education, and I pursued a minor in special ed. And as I was going through my program, I really enjoyed the content, but I really did not want to go into the classroom. And so I found myself kind of torn because I'm like, well, why am I still in this program? And I really don't want to go into the classroom. But there was nothing else that I could identify that made sense for me to pursue as a major. And so I had conversations with other individuals in the program, like, are you sure you want to teach? Like, yeah, I want to teach. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to ask him this tomorrow. And I kept asking that question over and over again. And I felt so different from the other individuals in the program who seemed to just know this is what they wanted to do. They probably like woke up out of the crib their first day in the crib and knew they wanted to teach. And I didn't feel that way. And so those were conversations that really forced me to think about why was I in this program. Another conversation that was pretty typical was at the time there was a lot of talk about No Child Left Behind and being a highly qualified teacher. And so in addition to being in this education program, I'm like, I need to go back to school to be a highly qualified teacher because I didn't have any other idea what I was going to do with my degree besides go into teaching and then try to figure it out then. So anyway, that's kind of how my process was for me. As I was able to go out and have my field experiences, I was not any more drawn to teaching, but what I found was I was interested in education, and I wanted to be able to support the educational environment. And so I began to entertain this idea of how do you bring in these other factors that influences a student's ability to learn. And so I started to look into like this holistic approach to education. So how does the family dynamic feed into what takes place in the classroom? How does the school itself feed into what takes place into the classroom? And so by forcing myself to ask those questions from my peers and really just being honest with myself that my feelings are not changing about this, it forced me to continue to ask questions to figure out, well, what is it that I like about education? And so if you find yourself in that place, I encourage you to really just ask the tough questions and don't wait for someone else to answer it, because believe it or not, you have some degree of an answer to help get you further along in the process of figuring out what it is you want to do or where you're going to start. So anyway, I'm thinking about this holistic approach to education, and then I'm thinking about, man, I'm gonna have to be a highly qualified teacher. I'm gonna have to go back to school. Do I really want to stop and then go out into the field and then go back? Like, what does that look like? And since I was still in this place of not being completely sure, I decided to go straight into graduate school. But because I was beginning to entertain this idea of a holistic approach to education, I decided to pursue my master's degree in family and child studies because I really wanted to understand that other dynamic that influenced students' abilities to be educated and educated effectively. Within that program, I decided, you know what, I need to just go ahead and get into the classroom somewhere. I felt like it was kind of safe to do it that way because I still knew that there was something else I was doing. And so what I began to do was I would reach out to peers that were in the program who had graduated earlier, people that I knew, and I would actually go visit classrooms. Now I have a chance to talk to individuals without maybe a supervising teacher there. Like, I really wanted to hear the honest experience. And so that was really helpful because what I found was by talking to some of my peers who were just right into the field, they had developed some insight about how maybe they would have done it differently had they known what they knew then. So that was really helpful. So one of the things I'm encouraging you all to do is to engage with the individuals that you know, whether they are friends of parents that you have, whether they're peers who have graduated earlier, stay connected to individuals, and really absorb the feedback that they have to give. Now, it doesn't mean that you have to apply everything that they're saying, but those are resources there that will really help you to understand how you fit into this educational process if you're gonna go into the field in some way. So anyway, I started to do that, and then I decided that I wanted to see if I could teach at the college level. So while I was in school, I pursued an adjunct teaching position, and there were entry-level courses. Some courses can be taught if you have a bachelor's degree, depending on the school, depending on the program. Some courses require you to have a master's degree. So even with the early childhood education background, it allowed me to be able to kind of test that out. So that was something else that I was able to kind of see if I really wanted to teach, but just not at the early child education level. So that's what I did, and I really enjoyed it. I loved it because what it did for me was it gave me a bigger picture about this educational process. So if I were to go into education at the early childhood phase, I'm looking at the results of education now. So this is what our students are equipped with as a result of having gone through this process. So I began to kind of dig into that to see why that was sort of thing. So anyway, got through my master's program, and I decided that I wanted to continue to adjunct part-time, but then I was also looking for a full-time work. And so at the time that I graduated, it was right in the summer. And so I began to work downtown Cincinnati at a charter school called W.E.B. Du Bois. And this was a really great experience because you had individuals who had retired out of education, out of the public school system, and now they've come back to help support this environment. I was able to kind of work with other teachers, but I didn't have to commit for a year. And so I could kind of test it out for a summer. And it brought me back to the same place. I really enjoy education, very passionate about it, but I don't want to be in the classroom. I want to find out how I can help to create resources, how I can help to create environments that support what takes place in the classroom. So for me, that process was really discovering how I can be an advocate for what takes place in the classroom. So after that, I applied for a job with the Urban League, and the Urban League was associated with, the Urban League was affiliated with Cincinnati Public School Districts, and so what they had, or what they have still, is they have after-school programs that are grant-funded. And so I was hired because I did pursue my license, and so I was a licensed educator, and they were looking for someone who was licensed to basically help with the training and development that would take place when teachers are trying to educate the students in the Cincinnati Public Schools after school. So basically what the program looked like, they were K-8 programs, and what we did was we brought in tutors. These were individuals who may also have been in teaching programs, so they were currently in college. These were also teachers who had retired maybe 30, 35 years, and now they were just kind of wanting to come back and continuing to support work in education. These were also educators who were teachers in the school buildings where we provided the services. And so after school was over, they would come also and help support students. And so this is something that I was able to manage because of having a license in teaching. And so with that, it was an opportunity for me to work with the community. It was more of that holistic approach that I was looking for. I had an opportunity to work with the community, and there were a lot of resources. We had individuals who ran businesses, and they would come in and teach the students how to develop a business and run a business. We had individuals from the hospital who would come in and give health-based programming. But my position required me to go out and find that. It required me to look at the components of the grant that supported this after-school program and see how we can find information, we can find content that aligned with that. So in a sense, what that was the components of the grant were like the standards that you all are taught to develop lesson plans from. And so with understanding how to align content to objectives, and then making sure that the content was age appropriate was a skill that I was able to bring right in to the environment. Something else that I was able to do was actually design the process for how instruction needed to take place. So I developed the lesson plan template for the program. And just to back up a little bit, both programs had about 200 students. The staff collectively was about 35 individuals. And then you also had additional individuals coming in and out of the schools each day. And so the education background really helped me. Then the family and child studies master's degree helped me to understand how to engage with the various individuals. So after working in that space, I decided that I wanted to go back to school, and I had an opportunity to actually come back to Miami University on the Hamilton campus as an academic advisor. So I knew, hey, I'm gonna go back, I'm gonna advise, and then I'm gonna go to school part-time. Well, I ended up advising full-time for a little bit over 3 years. And in this particular position, what I would do was I would provide general advising. So we had individuals who were veterans, individuals who own businesses, and now they decided, hey, I don't wanna do this anymore. I need to go back and do something else. We had individuals who were international, who were doctors in their country, and the license won't work here. So they had to come back. They were, while they're here, they had to pursue something that would allow them to work here. Really had opportunity to work with a wide range of individuals, worked in the community with emancipated foster youth. So how do we support individuals who really want an education, but they don't have any other support around to help them to be able to navigate this process? And so in that experience, what really helped me the most was understanding how to deal with people on a case-by-case basis. And so one, I can't just go say, hey, take these classes, you wanna go to school for X, Y, Z, okay, go and do X, Y, Z. What I needed to do was understand why. What is it that you were wanting to do? What type of resources, experiences, skills are you bringing to the table? And so what that means is, by bringing that to the table, this is where we need to start to make sure that you get what you need to get through the rest of this process. That's what the education program allowed me to do. In addition to that, it helped me to understand how to help monitor that process. So with education, it teaches you how to, one, find relevant content for an individual, make sure that you distribute that content in a manner where the individual can digest it. You're just not throwing it all on them at once, as Megan pointed out earlier. But then also the accountability factor, the follow-through. Are they getting what they need? So the advising piece worked well just with the teacher training that I obtained. In that position also, I had a chance to work closely with the Office of Learning Assistance. In this office, we had a lot of intake in regards to testing, trying to figure out what students' particular needs were when we're looking at the core of academics. So in reading, writing, and mathematics, we would test them. And then we would see if there were any additional supports that they needed so that they can get to a place where they could take college level courses or better navigate the college courses that they were required to navigate. So that's what that did for me. So anyway, how did I get to where I am today? So I stopped advising July 2014. to return to school to pursue my doctorate in ed leadership, because in all of those experiences, what I was able to define for myself is I do believe in a holistic approach to education. And given the amount of time I've had to kind of think about it and the plethora of experiences that I've had, I really want to work in education at a larger level. I'm interested in policy and how I can create policies that impact the environments that I'm saying, hey, I want to see success take place in these environments for learning. So that kind of brings me full circle. What I found is, even if you cannot name specifically what you are going to do with your degree, there are some consistencies about yourself that you keep coming back to. And so for me, I kept coming back to one, wanting to see people develop, but wanting to see them develop as a whole person and not just as a student who is majoring in kinesiology or a student who is majoring in education. And so as I began to allow myself to be true to understanding that about myself, I was able to go seek out experiences that helped me to develop in that manner. And so there's a core about yourself. Some people will argue that there is no self, there is no core, but I believe there's a core about yourself, and this is a conversation worth having with people who are closest to you. So parents are great at that, friends, some things that they may notice in you if you're kind of struggling with that, and just trying to figure out how you can take that core and really apply it in a way where you can direct it towards a career. So getting past that, some tips that I often gave to the students that I would advise were, one, you don't have to know exactly what you want to do, but I know you're trying to figure it out quick, fast, and in a hurry. So something that I would encourage them to do is just go and make fake profiles. It could be through different job engines, search engines. Do it now. So pretend like you have your degree in hand, the one you're pursuing. Make a profile. What's going to happen is you're going to start getting a lot of hits for different types of jobs based on the credentials that you've put in. And so also allow yourself to be open. So don't say, oh, I just want to stay over here. Allow yourself to be open to possibly moving to other states. Not necessarily that you're going to move, but what this is going to do is it's going to give you a bunch of resources to reference to see, oh, so I can actually do this with my degree, but this is like a California thing. Oh, I can do this with my degree, but I need to move to X, Y, and Z. So what I'm saying is you don't have to wait to find the answer. You don't have to wait to figure out where you're going to explore or where you're going to apply your degree. You can do that now. And you'll get hits daily if you really do this. And then what you want to do is you want to look at what they're requiring. Are they saying, hey, you can step right out of school into this job? Do you need 5 years of experience in order to move into this job? So if you are kind of feeling like you just don't really know how to navigate the degree that you have, it's just a matter of kind of jumping into technology and allowing it to tell you what your options look like. And then you don't have to commit to it for the rest of your life. It's something you can try out, and if it doesn't work, transition on to the next thing. But now what do you have? You have a resource that allows you to better define what comes next. Was that 10 minutes?
Sure.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Nicole Lewin, and I am one of the recruiters at Tier 1 Performance Solutions. My background is not in education. My background is in human resources. But I, a lot of the people that we talk to are past educators like Natasha. Like she told you, we focus on learning people and performance. So I look for people that have a passion for learning. I know that you've heard that many times out here today. But that is what I'm looking for. So I'm looking for people that want to help others. So we do look at education degrees. So there is hope if you don't want to teach it in the classroom. We're also, with our instructional designers, we do ask, we are looking for master's degrees in instructional design or education, but we do look at bachelor's degrees also. So if that's something that you're interested in, I would definitely start taking a look at the instructional design aspect of it, because you do get that curriculum, you do get to do the things that you love to do, but you don't have to necessarily do it in the classroom.
if you want to change your mind, come back for dinner.
That was all because Natasha did such a great job that we played it that she was going to talk the most of the time. So I wanted to open it up to you guys to see if you had any questions to me as a recruiter of what I am looking for to see if I can help you guys at all. Yes. On your resume, I would definitely start with putting that passion for learning in your resume. That places that you student taught, clubs that you have that you're a part of, organizations that you're a part of. What and focus it on the learning aspect of it. If you're looking for a job that's focusing on learning, you definitely want to put that highlight that. And in your objective statement, if you do still add an objective statement, I would put have a passion for learning, want to have a position that has learning-based or people and performance-based, but I would definitely focus on classes that you've taken, jobs that you've done, organizations that you belong to, and anything that can highlight your ability to teach.
Is going to. Can I borrow somebody's? You have to borrow somebody's microphone. Maybe this is a good time to just open it up to questions. Does anybody have? Did anybody fill out the card or?
I just have a question.
Okay, hang on. Hang on. Okay.
I had a question about the event coordinator position for highlights. Do you have to have a master's degree for that if you had like previous experience?
No, you do not need a master's degree for that. We do like our event coordinators to have an undergraduate degree, and most of them have some teaching experience. Those are the people at the different events that I referenced that would, they'll do, it is a jack of all trades kind of job. Because you've got to bring people in and get them registered, you're using the computer, we have product sales, we've got author signings, so you're running around like a chicken with your head cut off. But there is part of why we really like education majors for that is because there are literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of options for the different segments that the participants can go to that are there. And so being able to understand fundamentals of education and really help somebody piece together a customized program, that's really helpful.
Thanks.
Going off of that, are the positions listed on here, do you mostly look for candidates with bachelor's degrees, or do most of the people you hire have master's?
That's a great question. Most of the people that we hire, we've got a nice mix. We do hire people direct, and again, like you think about some of like the editorial positions, that would be the kind of job that with a bachelor's degree, you'd come in literally the very entry-level of an editorial professional. But for people who have been in the classroom and have years of experience, who have a master's degree, maybe got some of the instructional design piece, because that's such an important part when you think about, some of the, like Zeno Blozer curriculum design, some of the product development there, and then the SDE, but even the early childhood knowledge that's required for some of the editorial work that we do at Highlights. We have a really nice mix. And we also have continuing education. So for people that we hire in undergrad, we have a continuing education program for people who are like, yeah, I really like this, and I want to advance my career. But for many of the jobs, it's not a requirement either.
What other questions?
I guess I just kind of want to throw out a question to everyone. Would you suggest us to get master's degrees before trying to apply for some of the alternative jobs? Or would you say, like, staying at a bachelor's degree would
be good enough?
I think for some of the positions that we've heard about today, it depends on what you want to do. So if you want to, if you would want to go to highlights, then they do have bachelor positions. If for our company, we do look at master's programs, but we have also looked at people with just, not just bachelor's degrees, but bachelor's degrees also. It depends on your experience and where you've taken your education and how much you've put into your education. So I'm sorry to, that's my 2 cents.
Actually, I agree, yes, and I have a little different perspective from just my personal experience. When people ask me that question, I almost always recommend that they get a few years of work experience under their belt. And I will tell you from my own personal experience, I would have never gotten a master's in human resources had I not known and had that work experience and found my niche. So especially if you're kind of not sure, but even if you end up going straight into the classroom, having some years of experience and going back to school, I truly believe you get more out of it. But it's a bias of mine. So.
And I agree with that too, because I actually went back and got my bachelor's in human resources after being out of school for a while. Mm-hmm. So you do get, after I worked for Walmart for 7 years in human resources, so doing that and then going back to school, I got so much more out of it. So having that work experience does help too.
Yeah. What would you think, Megan?
I would say in the not-for-profit world, if you are in the director level or executive director level, I have met people with master's degrees, and sometimes they've focused on the MBA piece of it or master's of public administration. I don't believe our current executive director has a master's. A lot of that has been life experience and work experience. I will say, following up what they've said, I went back years afterwards knowing I always wanted to get a master's degree just because I love learning. If by the time I graduated Miami, I was not ready to leave, I would have stayed another 10 years and just kept learning. So I am an education junkie, and I knew I wanted to go back and get a master's degree because I knew that would advance my career or advance my own personal life to an extent. And so I explored different areas in which I wanted to invest that time. And so having the time to be in a work environment and still explore other options, take a day and go shadow somebody in the occupational therapy world, or shadow somebody in the business world, shadow somebody in a law office and see what that looked like. I mean, I did all of that, and then I took the most rational route I could find and went back and got a master's in theology. Which is very practical.
Did you follow a minister?
I did not follow a minister. And I joke that it was a very expensive way to do therapy for myself, but what I found was it tied into my philosophy of working with people in that I was coaching them. So I started with coaching kids in learning how to do a physical skill, and now from my life experience, I moved to coaching people in becoming more of themselves. That sounds very grandiose, but
that's cool.
It is, having the Masters of Theology has helped expand that into a different way, because when you're starting to work with people over the age of 55 or 65, they're getting to the point of life where lots of life hits them, and life just isn't about career. It's about enjoying living because you're happy to be on the planet still, depending on your life experience. And I mean, even at 40, that happens, and you learn to go on. So people come at it from a different perspective when you are teaching them, you're coaching them. And just to qualify my earlier comment about teaching is sales, I mean that in the very broad perspective. not that you are selling a product, but you are selling the idea. You are selling them on, here's what you want to know. And so if you were to apply that to a sales job, it's one thing. If you're applying that to an English lit course, it applies to a different thing. So just to qualify that a little more.
I completely agree with what everyone has said. Regardless of the next, well, not regardless, if you decide to pursue a master's degree, you need to be clear about why that makes sense. But if you're doing it to kind of like buy time, that's not a good reason to pursue it. Because in the program, whatever the program is, you're gonna have to be able to articulate your reasoning. And so even if it's not in a job where it starts, start to ask those questions, start to investigate why, if you're thinking about a master's, that particular master's makes sense. But I would not just jump into it, no.
I had a question that I would like you to address for the students in the audience that are preparing to become teachers. It's easy to often get sidetracked by the end point, the credential, my master's, my... But I would like you to, and I've heard it throughout your discussions, but to specifically address the skill sets that you are looking for as employers. What is it that makes a teacher educator so employable outside of the classroom?
I know we're looking for people that have, like I said, a passion for learning. We're looking for people that can take a problem that a company has, even if the company doesn't know what the problem is, mm-hmm. and get in there and investigate and ask the questions. So it's that critical thinking that teachers have for education and learning people and how people react to different problems and solutions. So that's some of the biggest things. We're looking for people that enjoy talking with others, that have a passion and excitement when what they teach and what people learn from them makes their life better. You know, we have different clients. We have P&G, we have Macy's, we have all these different. So the people that we're affecting, it's a broad spectrum of people, and it's making their lives better. So we want to see people, we want applicants that want to see people better because of how they've taught. So you don't have to do that in a classroom. You can do that mm-hmm. through an e-learning course. You can do that through an instructor-led training. You can do that with the different positions that are out there. You don't necessarily just have to do it.
I would just throw in, my dad used to always say to me, figure out what you love to do, then find a way to get paid for it.
Yep.
So again, I'm gonna reiterate the whole passion thing. You're hearing it from all of us. So it highlights we are looking for a passion for children and education because we are very much mission driven. And I think your skill sets are spot on. Would add, you know, for some of the jobs that we have, collaboration is really important because the kind of work we do. Communication skills. I know you guys will have some more, so I'll just throw in a couple.
I would say I was hired for my current job from another Miami grad, and she graduated from School of Performing Arts here. It's probably not the official title anymore, but it's what it was. And when they hired me, when I went through this massive interview process and sat in front of 12 people in a group interview, you have to be able to be cool in front of a group of people. You have to be able to find that center and say, I know what I'm doing, I'm selling myself. Who would have thought I'd be pushing sales? I'm sorry. The other piece of that is it goes back to your passion, but your passion for learning, not just teaching it, but you have to constantly be learning. Mm-hmm. Learning about whatever job it is you're going into. You go into that job interview and you have already studied and know what skill sets Highlights might be looking for. You have done your research. Teachers can do that because you have to do it every time you come up with a new lesson plan. My boss, the whole reason I brought her up, said when after she hired me and was talking to the group, she said, you know, you may not have had performing arts background. We can teach that. We can't teach people skills. They're looking for the people skills. Other skills can be taught.
I don't know how much I can add to that. Education is an interdisciplinary field. You can't name any student here who is here and not going through a teaching process. Not going through a process where they're being taught. And so there is no specific set of skills that you can say these are the only skills, because it really is relative. It depends on the job that you may be applying for. And I've been asked that question a lot when I was in an advisor role. And honestly, the best answer I could give would be to just kind of test it out, play with search engines. And I've had so many students come back and their plan is just like laid out because they've had a chance to see with their own eyes what the options look like. And they were able to explain for themselves what skills that they possess, what skills they acquired by being in the program that they had to be able to move forward with. And so I think these answers are great, but there are so many ways that you can apply the skills that you have, and how it's defined looks different depending on what you're doing. So just know you have a lot of options, but don't just know it, like really investigate what's out there.
I will throw in one more tidbit too, and that is do not forget your network. And I will tell you, they are pushing it like crazy over at Farmer. And it holds true. I don't care what profession you're in. Be on LinkedIn. Think about, you know, you're meeting professionals up here that, you know, you want to have that network, that connection, stay in contact with people, because it's those bridges. You listen to all of our paths. And I mean, none of us would have projected when we were sitting in your seats that we were going to have careers that looked like they did. And it was through relationships and networks and being open to possibilities. So do keep in mind the importance of managing your networks.
And I know when I was going through undergrad, Career Services had a job fair that I attended. And it was really helpful in just seeing the different types of employers who came and wanted to hire teacher education majors. So find out when those are, when those are coming up, and make sure that you're ready to attend. And so I believe there's a course now that a student may need to take. I'm not sure if it's like a certain so many sessions, but get your resumes ready and be ready to attend those things, because that will help to answer that question as well.
I would like to throw in, talking on Career Services, I will say I didn't even know Career Services existed when I was here, because I thought it was always for business majors. And now that I'm doing mock interviews, coming on board and helping you practice, I would say take advantage of those. Take advantage of as many as you can, because what you are doing is practicing learning people. It's not just presenting yourself in the best light, which is excellent practice, but you are practicing reading what that interviewer is picking up from you. And that is a vital skill to learn either in the classroom or in any other field that you are in. It's learning two ways.
One more thing. When I utilized the service, they actually provided me a mock interview specific to the type of job I thought I was interested in. And so it was really a great way to kind of ease some of the jitters going into an interview, but the questions are very specific to what you may be interested in. So that's a resource that students, when I was coming through school, did not use enough, but it's one of the best resources that you could use. So really jump on that opportunity.
That's where we, for our company, we're going to 9 different universities in the next 2 months, and one of them is Miami, and we've utilized their career services and posted jobs there, and we'll be on campus on the 6th. And that was, it's a great tool. And Chrissy, who's our contact at the career services, so helpful and just want to help students find what they want to do. So I would and get your resume on the Career Services site, so because that's how we were pulling resumes to invite people to go on to apply. So you definitely want to use those Career Services. They're there to help.
And if I could just add something, what Genesis was talking about is you have to come to what's called basic interviewing skills or making employer contacts and interviewing for teacher candidates. And we'll talk a little bit more about how you use what we call Miami Career Link for employers who come to campus and want to interview all majors. And also, I want to plug, thank you for plugging the mock interviews, because I think it does really make you feel better. And farmer students have, probably from the very first day they walk into that building, this network and the support and the professors who are polishing them. And there, for them, it's just natural. I can tell a farmer student that, you know, they shake my hand even if I really haven't met them. So, but when an employer at career fairs, and I would encourage you to come, when you can articulate why you're a good candidate, they know that you've done your homework, they know you've done your research, and they find out that you're an education major, they're blown away. I mean, if you can tell them, now they may ask you, so why don't you want to teach? So you have to be prepared for that. But they are very much interested in all majors besides just business majors.
It's so, true.
You know, keep that in mind and realize that you do have something to offer. And come see me. We'll practice it and we'll talk about it. Or come to some of our other programs and look at some of those myriad of newsletters that I send you that aren't education related. Yes.
Oh, hello.
Hi. Hello.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi. Did any of you think that given the opportunity that you would go back to the degree that you got, the teaching degree, or do you feel like what you do now is something that you enjoy way more than you enjoy teaching?
I would do it again in a heartbeat. As I've said, I'm teaching every day. It's just not in the structured environment that I was taught about here. I took almost every bit of the education experience and I brought it forward. I think anyway. My professors that taught me may disagree, but life is life. I mean, you take what you need and you drop the rest. But I wouldn't have changed it.
For me, I really haven't stepped away from it. What I kind of learned in advising is that you're not pursuing just a degree. You're pursuing a set of skills that are represented in a degree. So I would not be able to have done what I've done without the skill sets that I've obtained through my education degree. So to answer your question, would I do it again? Yeah, this is working.
Not education majors.
Yep.
I would have done it again and gone and stuck with education. Do you buy that?
Do what makes you happy. That's my advice.
Yep.
It might not be the path that you think it is. It could be completely different. So I've seen too many people at my company who started out as teachers in the classroom and are now in this company that's growing and helping people. And they're so much happier, and they'll tell you that they're so much happier. And it's not anything against teachers in the classroom. It's just what they love and what they want to do.
And I see that as no different than a teacher in a classroom moving up, becoming a principal, yep. And becoming an administrator. It's the same process.
I do feel obligated to put in a small plug, though, and I know the whole idea of this panel has been about alternative careers for education majors. But I have known way too many teachers who are passionate about teaching, who make a difference in children's lives, and will say things like, I'm just a teacher, and it drives me crazy,
mm-hmm.
Because it is a fabulous profession. There are very few jobs that you, and I don't know many of us up here that have had moments where we really believed we changed lives. And you may have bad days in the classroom, but you do change lives. And so I also want to make sure that you know from, and I know I speak for all of us, teaching is a fabulous profession, and you have choices.